Good morning. Welcome to worship at St. Paul's United Methodist Church in Lenexa. We're so glad to be together. If you're with us at home, we want to welcome you to wherever you are today. Thank you for joining. Wherever you are, we'd love for you to sign in. You can scan the code on the screen. It also gives us your prayer requests, your joys and concerns. And so we would love to hear from you. We'd love to pray with you. A few announcements I want to make. First of all, next weekend, we'll finish out this series, one more week of the KC Heart Emphasis on the Art series. We are going to celebrate Reconciling Sunday and do a baptismal remembrance. And we are a reconciling congregation. Our welcome statement that you'll hear in a little bit is part of what that means. And so we want to celebrate that each year and have a chance to remember who we are as a congregation, who God has called us to be. You will also see in the newsletter there are going to be chances in February through Love Council to write to our healthcare workers, and so put that on your radar as something to sign up for, to care for those who are caring for us. Seek Team is doing learning on locations this Saturday, the Nelson at 10 a.m. Pastor Sandra will be leading a group. So if you'd like to go, she can share more. You can see more about that in the newsletter. Serve on February 6th, I want to make sure to get on your radar. The blood drive is happening. We're a little low on numbers on signups so far, and so if you are interested in donating blood, there's a shortage. They would love it, and you don't even have to leave the church to do it. And so you can come to church and you can donate blood. A great chance to serve, and Meredith Christian would love to talk more about it with you if you're interested or need help getting signed up. But it's a great way to serve. And so, with that being said, let us stand as you're comfortable and join in our call to worship.
When I think of God's presence in the world, I'm grateful. Grateful for the presence of hope, grateful for the gift of life. And when I think of God's presence in my life, I am humbled. Humbled by the gift of grace, humbled by the invitation to begin again. And when I think of God's presence in this community, I am glad. Glad to be surrounded by holy people worshiping our holy God. Thank you all. Thank you, God.
Let us remain standing and join in our opening hymn, Come and Find the Quiet Center.
Come and find the quiet center in the crowded life we lead. Find the room for hope to enter. Find the frame where we are freed. Clear the chaos and the clutter, clear our eyes that we can see all the things that really matter. Be at peace and simply be. Silence is a friend who claims us, cools the heat and slows the pace. God it is who speaks and names us, knows our being, touches base, making space within our thinking, lifting shades to show the sun, raising courage when we're shrinking, finding scope for faith begun. In the Spirit, let us travel, open to each other's pain. Let our lives and fears unravel, celebrate the space we gain. There's a place for deepest dreaming. There's a time for heart to care. In the spirit's lively scheming, there is always room to spare.
Let's affirm our faith together. We, the people of St. Paul's United Methodist Church, believe that God's love is expansive and unconditional, and that through Christ, God calls us to love one another as God loves us. We welcome all people, regardless of gender, race, age, cultural or religious heritage, ethnic background, sexual orientation, gender identity, gender expression, economic circumstances, family configuration, or difference of ability. We celebrate the worth, dignity, and gifts of every person as a child of God.
Glory be to the Father. Without end.
Amen. My goodness. Thank you, choir. Kids, it's time to head to Kids Connection with Pastor Geneva. We will cheer you on as you head out. We continue our series today, KC Heart, KC Art, and our scripture today is from Micah chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. Hear these words. In days to come, the mountains of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised up above the hills. People shall stream to it, and many nations shall come and say, Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many peoples, and shall arbitrate between strong nations far away. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. But they shall all sit under their own vines and under their own fig trees, and no one shall make them afraid. For the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. For all the peoples walk, each in the name of its God. But we will walk in the name of the Lord our God. Forever and ever. Will you pray with me? God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each and every one of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For God, you are our rock and our strength and our redeemer. Amen. I shared a couple weeks ago that Kansas City has over 200 murals in the metro. 11 of those murals are painted by a man named Alexander Austin. One of his most famous and well-known murals is the Kansas City Jazz Mural in the Power and Light District. When it was created in 2008, it was always known that one day it would be hidden by development. Only in the past year, though, has that construction blocked our view from seeing Count Basie, the silhouettes of the jazz group, and that iconic intersection of 18th and Vine painted there. Alexander Austin also painted the Buck O'Neill mural near the Negro Leagues Baseball Museum. It's on the side of the historic YMCA at 19th and Paseo. It was the first civic center in Kansas City built to serve African Americans. Buck O'Neill was a first baseman and manager in the named Negro American League, mostly with the Kansas City Monarchs, and became the first African American coach in Major League Baseball. Austin's mural is something like four stories high. He's painted a Royals mural and a couple of Chiefs murals, the one that's in the Power and Light District after 2020's big win. And there's one of Mahomes by himself. Alexander Austin has been featured in Essence Magazine, the New York Times, the Washington Post, Time Magazine. His work has been in commercials and TV specials. You would never know that someone who was once voted one of Kansas City's top 100 most influential people started his time in our city, experiencing the full effects of addiction, and was living on the streets. Austin grew up in Florida and loved art. He credits that to his mother. She would sew fancy church clothes for ladies at their church, and he got his artistic talent and start cutting out patterns with his mom. They never had a lot of money. His mom raised him and his 11 siblings in public housing in Tallahassee. One of his sisters died of gun violence just down the road from their home. He failed the 7th grade and the 9th grade, And by high school, he found that the only things he was showing up for at school were lunch and art class. And so he dropped out. Addiction ran in his family, and he soon joined. His father, who left when Austin was 8 years old, was an alcoholic. Several of his sisters struggled with alcohol. And when Austin was 16 years old, he remembers begging for money outside the liquor store with his friends, gathering enough change for a fifth of whiskey. He experimented with drugs. He stuck with alcohol. He worked on his GED in graphic art, but his drinking interfered with job opportunities as a young adult. He was arrested for not paying his child support that he couldn't afford because he wasn't keeping his jobs because of his alcoholism. It was a cycle that seemed to not end. The only reason he stayed out of jail after that in Florida was because he entered a piece of art in the North Florida Fair, and a painter named Alan Pippinger was so taken by his piece that he paid $1,000 to keep Austin out of jail. And Austin paid him back in art and learned alongside of him. A few years later, Austin's sister in Kansas City got sick. And so he got on a Greyhound bus and headed this way, knowing that Hallmark was here. And there were some advertising agencies here. And so he brought his portfolio, and he hoped for the best. And because his education was so limited, he continued to face rejection. And without work, he was evicted and too embarrassed to ask for his sister's help. And so he slept under the steps of the Valentine Shopping Center, in the stoops of buildings downtown, and even in the park on a Paseo right across the street from his sister's house. It took him a few weeks to find a place to sleep at City Union Mission, and he was out one day trying to find a job. He was walking, and he saw a man on a ladder painting a small sign. And it turns out that this man, Hank Bloomquist was his name, was also houseless, living in abandoned buildings and painting signs for a few bucks each. And Austin asked if he could help. And the two lived together in an empty, rodent-ridden warehouse on Truman Road for months. Bloomquist only had one rule. Austin needed to be drug and alcohol free. And so he started going to AA. He got sober. And that sign painting team led him to think in bigger ways about his painting and in new ways about where he could paint. He perfected style and different techniques, and he pitched ideas to building owners, said, "All I need is the paint." He painted a mural about education breaking the chains of ignorance, then one about Malcolm X, and then one about Dr. King, and he worked odd jobs to just keep his apartment, but still wanted to paint. In 1995, Austin went to Alvin Brooks, civil rights activist and public servant in our city, with an idea to paint a mural memorializing homicide victims in our city. "When will it stop?" it read, and then faces of 100 murder victims went up at 27th and Prospect. It was even featured on an HBO documentary on gun violence and drugs in our city. A few years later, it was painted over, because there was not funding to keep the message going. He painted on and off, but said, "This art thing is a struggle. You're either in or you're out. I've been on the brink of being homeless again all the time for years." He said it was partly because he's not much of a businessman. He's done most of his murals for free or for a couple $100 to be able to buy groceries. When Austin agreed to the $44,000 for the massive Power and Light mural, he thought the project was going to take 8 weeks, not 8 months. He spent $15,000 of that $44,000 on the paint and brushes alone, another $3,000 on the insurance required by federal authorities to run the hydraulic lift he needed that he'd already spent $12,000 on. By the project's finish, Austin only pocketed a few thousand dollars. The good news is that painting helped propel his career and his notoriety, and the bad news is that painting is about to be completely blocked by a new building. Now it's hidden by construction. And I'm so interested in Austin's journey from a high school dropout in Tallahassee begging for money to buy booze to an incredibly gifted artist whose work graces our city and some of our most well-known and well-treasured places. From City Mission to City's Most Influential. In 2009, he did a mural on the wall of a multi-purpose room back at City Mission, in their, at the time, New Christian Life Center. It depicted men going through the progression of struggle and pain to victory. He called it Journey of Hope. In 2019, he painted a mural on the mission's outside wall that depicted the various stages and journeys of people experiencing homelessness. And what is so interesting to me is that in 2020 and 2021, when activists in the city went to paint the six Black Lives Matter murals that popped up on our city's streets, you know what photo was used in the press releases before those murals happened? It was one of Alexander Austin's murals, one that sits at Linwood and Troost, actually, and its peeling facade still clearly shows Dr. King and Rosa Parks fighting for justice. Black and white photos of each of them in iconic positions. King in the middle of speeches and Parks with that incredible mugshot, right, after her arrest. It's like sometimes Alexander Austin paints a sort of idealized pull yourself up by the bootstraps kind of message. That if you just go to school and have hope, then everything's going to be okay. And sometimes Austin's art, it is giant paintings of giants like Buck O'Neill and Count Basie who were so gifted that they were celebrated despite the oppression of the times. And sometimes Austin's paintings are the gateway to a movement of justice, policy and systemic change that the Black Lives Matter movement over the past 2 years brought light to. And I'm going to be really honest here, the more I learned about this man, the more conflicted I felt about telling his story. Because there's something about it that says, if you just try hard enough and get educated, you won't be an addict, and you won't be poor, and you won't be homeless, and you won't be bad at business. And don't get me wrong, I'm so glad that Alexander Austin received the help that he did and had the gifts that he did. He said he found Jesus at the City Mission and credits that conversion to his changed life. Never underestimate the power of God and what God can do in your life, he said. And you know what I hope that he gets to paint on a wall one day? Hope that looks like equity in education for kids in public housing, the same as kids in this zip code. One day, might there be hope painted that looks like business people and artists collaborating and each being valued for the gifts that they have to share with a compensation that allows a roof over their head? Could he paint hope that looks like homes for our houseless neighbors and restorative support for parents experiencing addiction so that their children don't have to pay the price? Could he paint a cycle broken because a broken system changed? Hope that looks like the same kind of unifying pride people have taking selfies in front of Patrick Mahomes' mural as they do in front of Rosa Parks or the Black Lives Matter murals. Could he one day paint hope that looks not like the memorial for gun violence asking when will it end, but one that says swords into plowshares? Or we study war no more because the truth we find in Scripture is realized and there is a day that is different. There will be a day when everyone lives under their own vine and fig tree and no one makes them afraid. A day when they have freedom and homes. Micah is a prophetic book. A truth teller about the times as they were, but also how God intends the world to be. The first three chapters of Micah include a pretty strong judgment, so the part we read today is sort of the hope on the other side of one's back against the wall. There was fear that Israel would be destroyed by enemies, like actually destroyed, fighting, war. And whether that was because of that's just how evil works, or whether they were the ones making evil choices was a little bit up in the air. But either way, they needed some hope. In the beginning of chapter 4 that we read today said, In the days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains and shall be raised up above the hills. People shall stream to it, and many nations shall come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. So, this is a pronouncement that there will be a renewal of the nation. Like a second Mount Sinai, where Moses received the law and then shared it with God's people. And that instruction and teaching would not just be received, but be transformative for everybody. There was hope in receiving from God. And then Micah went on to say, he shall judge between many peoples and shall arbitrate between strong nations far away. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Now imagine this good news in context. Seeing a future where the very things that bring death are instead tools for planting is an image of the impossible made possible in a way that only God could offer. We don't have to fight. We don't have to be at odds with one another. We don't have to compete for security. In fact, that's where the next verse comes in, the one that we may or may not, I guess, know from Hamilton, the musical that we've so well memorized in America because George Washington was obsessed with that verse. He mentioned it like more than 50 times in his writings. The verse that says, but they shall all sit under their own vines and under their own fig trees, and no one shall make them afraid. This is what one scholar called an imaginative boldness, or maybe a courage of desperation. Because a glimpse of security like that had no place in their reality. Danger and fear had real places in their lives right then. But Micah spoke of a day when that would be different, God's day when that would be different, when people would walk in the name of our Lord, our God, forever. What would have to happen for a peace like that to come true? Which side stops fighting first? Which side turns all its weapons into something creative first? If Micah sees God's future without wars, but with justice, how does that work? In Micah's time, justice was fought. Justice was found through wars. Fighting is how they figured out what is right and good and ordered in the world. Micah said that what was going to happen was that God's judgment was going to replace any need for wars. God's ordering of the world is sufficient. God's kingdom would not bring fighting. Church, you need to know that this was beyond imagination. War was a real threat right then and right there. It was hard to imagine a pause in war, let alone no need to train. No need to prepare to have weapons. I think it's important to read the prophets every now and again because we need to be in the practice of imagining a world that could be different. Writer Dante Stewart said, I used to think that being a Christian was about preaching the right things, believing the right things, and performing the right ways. I've come to see that being a Christian is more about imagining a world more loving, more just, and more equal than the one we're offered. I've come to see that being a Christian is more about imagining a world more loving, more just, and more equal than the one we're offered. That's why I love thinking about the murals in our city and people like Alexander Austin. Because artists like him help us imagine a world more loving, more just, and more equal than the one we're offered. Alexander Austin went from living on the streets to a legacy that brought forth painting the streets. He went from pull yourself up by the bootstraps, a mindset that works really well for white Americans who are afforded the privileges of systems built for us, to inspiring the very roads we travel to be paved with equity. The 6 Black Lives Matter murals that proclaim a need for a world reimagined. My prayer is that when we see Alexander Austin's iconic works like the Buck O'Neill mural or the Jazz mural or the Chiefs or the ones to come, that we can also have some courageous imagination about what a world could look like that might have made Alexander Austin's life a little different. He said if he was educated, he would have been one of the greats, like Rembrandt or Mozart. But he had to settle for this. Can we imagine a world where this is what is great? Or at least imagine a world where his start didn't need to be in gun violence memorials or jobs in between stays in abandoned buildings. God's justice doesn't just look like one person and one life being able to scrape by into influence and success. It looks like a world so differently made that security might not be a far reach for anybody. Everyone will live under their own vine and fig tree. No one has to be afraid. So what does that look like for us as Christians to live as though we believe a different world is possible? I think for most of us, it looks like getting uncomfortable with the way things are, even in our comfort, and letting our own weapons be removed. What might benefit us that isn't benefiting all? Can we imagine a world in which those benefits looked more equitable, giving away our power? Because our ultimate security rests in the trust of God's kingdom, God's ordering of the world, and not the kingdom we can build ourselves. It might look like following the work of our Faith Voices for Medicaid expansion team, advocating for healthcare coverage for those who fall in a coverage gap. It might look like tuning into the Kansas legislative session a little more closely. Who does redistricting benefit? What can we do about that? It might look like showing up to the Shawnee City Council meeting or sending in your thoughts because of an aggressive anti-trans policy that's being proposed for our children. It might look like cheering on Wyandotte County's meeting Monday night as they adopt, hopefully safe and welcoming, a policy for the community that makes sure our immigrant neighbors don't have to be afraid where they live, regardless of their citizenship status. It might look like attending the 5th Sunday Forum next weekend between services and learn more about gender identity and gender expression and pronouns to further advocate for a world where the worth, dignity, and gifts of every child of God are celebrated and respected. It might even look like training our imaginations to see beyond one success story of someone who defied the systems that were created for him to succeed when he wasn't supposed to see beyond one story and know that it should not take someone's resilience and brilliance to get out of a place that's so bad. The world shouldn't work that way. It might even look like supporting local artists with your resources, so that their gifts are seen and valued just like the professions in your household. That they might not have to fight to make a living. That they might not have to study the war that is forced upon those between following a calling and paying the bills. It might even look like taking a step back from this pandemic and asking God to help us reimagine again, what a different world can look like. Cornel West says, empathy is not simply a matter of trying to imagine what others are going through, but having the will to muster enough courage to do something about it. Empathy is not simply a matter of trying to imagine what others are going through, but having the will to muster enough courage to do something about it. In a way, he says, empathy is predicated upon hope. So St. Paul's, in light of the God who gives us the courage and hope to imagine a world in which swords can be turned into plowshares, and war doesn't have to be studied anymore, and everyone will live under their own vine and fig tree, and no one will make them afraid, in light of God's kingdom vision and God's kingdom reality, what are we going to do about the world as it is? Will you receive the gift of good news and great promise? Will you muster the kind of empathy that leads you to see the world through another's eyes and let the heart, your heart, break at the injustice you see? And then will you do something about it? In a time when it feels like security is the only thing we can have to protect our families right now, are we willing to give some of it up to make sure another family might be protected too? Are we willing to drop the easy narratives of rags to riches if one just tries hard enough, and instead work toward what Mary, Jesus' mom Mary, said looked like the powerful falling down from their thrones, or what Micah said looks like trusting that God's ordering of the world is sufficient? Sufficient enough that we don't have to be the ones who put people in their place? Are we willing to paint a future we want to see with a clear vision for equity? Are we willing to paint the future we want to see because it's God's future? My prayer is yes. May it be so, and may it be soon. In the name of the Creator, and the Redeemer, and the Sustainer of us all. Amen. Chance. We have a chance to pray and to give back to God what is God's. One of the things that has been in my prayers this week is just the joy of new leadership and a new year. This week on Monday night, I had finance team. On Tuesday night, I had staff parish relations committee. Wednesday night was trustees, and Thursday night was church council. And each of those meetings was a glimpse of hope, of people who are serving God by serving others and giving so freely of their time and their laughter and their gifts. It's just a gift to be together. And so in that spirit, I would invite us to come and light a candle for the things that give you hope right now. What gives you a glimpse of hope that makes you believe that God's kingdom can come on earth as it is in heaven? We also go to God in our giving. I think that generosity is always a way that we can give back, that we can release some of what we have a hold on. And so let us go to God in prayer. Let us go to God in generosity.
Thank you.
Oh, bless the gifts our hands have brought, and bless the work our hearts have planned. Ours is the faith, our will, the thought. The rest, O God, is in your hand.
You may be seated. Let's pray together. Loving and gracious God, we are grateful to be able to come here today and to offer praise to you and to be able to worship together, whether in this room or online, because we know that we will hear your word and it will speak to us, and we'll leave here shaped a little bit more into the likeness of Jesus Christ. So we do come humbly and looking for that quiet center so we can hear your voice. And as we reflect, God, we thank you for those times this week where we smiled or laughed or heard some giggles or shared some joy with one another, for times of friendship and meals that were shared, or times when we appreciated the beauty of our city. God, we're grateful for those moments because it's a glimpse of what it means to feel whole as the person that you've created us to be, a glimpse of what it means to see each other as whole. And God, we also lift up to you this morning those days that were maybe a little more difficult, where there were some struggle, the times when we know, God, we were less than our best. We didn't give it our all. We didn't give it who we are. We didn't see one another for who we really are. And so we acknowledge that those moments, and we are grateful, God, that you don't ever turn away from us. And when we're honest about who we are and where we've fallen short, that you forgive us and you help us find a way to start anew. So we are grateful and offer you our love through our hearts. This morning, God, we also lift up our church. We want St. Paul's to be a strong and a vital church serving this community in ways of love and grace and justice. We want to be used by you to make a difference in the lives of other people, to help bring about more equitable living for each other. God, we know that the need for hope and love and compassion and acceptance is great. The need for change is great. And you are the answer to those needs. So we pray that you would help us be the church you want us to be, and through our ministries and through the way we live, be an example of your justice. We also lift up to you our country and its leaders. We pray for the change we need, God. We pray that egos and powers will be set aside. The desire for power to be set aside. And we pray that it's wisdom and vision and collaboration that will prevail. We need you, God. We need you in our country. We lift up those that we know are sick today, those who are suffering or lonely, in need of your presence and the light of your hope. We ask that you would touch them with your healing and your guidance, and especially your peace. We give you a moment. In this moment of silence, we offer to you the names of people near and dear to us in our hearts that we want to bring especially closer to you this morning. For all these things, God, we are grateful and joyful, and we are glad for the opportunity to be here in this place, in this moment, in this space, to pray and to praise you. For it brings us joy, and it brings us hope, and it brings us confidence. Confidence that the world is in your hand. And so we do lift our voices together this morning out of this joy, out of this confidence. We lift our voices together to pray the prayer that Christ has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us join, or stand and join as you're comfortable, in the singing of our closing hymn, For the Healing of the Nations.
For the healing of the nations, Lord, we pray with one accord. For a just and equal sharing of the things that earth affords, to a life of love in action, help us rise and pledge our word. Help us rise and pledge our word. Lead your people into freedom from despair, your world release. That redeemed from war and hatred, all may come and go in peace. Show us how through care and goodness, fear will die and hope increase. Fear will die and hope increase. All that kills abundant living, let it from the earth be banned. Pride of status, race, or schooling, dogmas that obscure your plan. In our common quest for justice, may we hollow life's brief span. May we hollow life's brief span.
I want to remind you, next Sunday is Reconciling Sunday. Saturday, folks are going to the Nelson. If you want to go to the Nelson, talk to Pastor Sanders. She'd love to share more about that. So good to be together. This gives me hope. This is what gives me hope. So as we go from this place, may the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit go with us now and always, that we might believe a day can be different. Go in peace and serve the Lord, and go Chiefs.